Seventh Circuit is this thing that does the DMOD. And we have a name for it. It's called a detector. That is an amplitude modulation demodulator. By the way, does anybody here know what a modem is? Or does?
Modulator, demodulator.
It's a modulator, demodulator. Why is it that? What's going on here? When you have a telephone line, which is what we used to use them on, you can also use them on a radio circuit. That works fine if you hook them up to your microphone or your speaker. In fact, if you have an old Hayes 1200, the manual in it had a page that was called ham radio that would say, okay, you packet radio lovers, here's how you use this Hayes modem to get your computer to talk to other people with their computers over the air. On a telephone line, you got a pair of wires. A pair of wires has a filter on it. And the filter circuit that the phone company imposes here says, I will pass a signal that's anywhere from 300 to 3,000 hertz. It uses actually 4,000 hertz blocks, but it uses everything below 300, everything from 3 to 4,000 for signaling. In other words, for handling all the traffic internally. The part you get to use when you talk is that. Why is that what you get? Well, it turns out if you analyze the human voice, it tends to peak at about 1,004 hertz is the exact number that the phone company and all of its years of research at Bell Telephone Laboratories said it was. And it really goes below 300, really goes above 3,000. About 95% of the power channel, channel power density is the proper term for it, fits in those boundaries. Yeah, women have a higher average frequency content, but even then it doesn't really get up there past 3,000 much. And that's all you need. Now, it's not 100% of the spectrum of your voice, which is why when you talk over the telephone, you have a telephone voice that doesn't sound 100% like a live communication. But you certainly can understand the other guy. And that's essentially what you need. Now, what do computers generate? They generate pulses. Pulses don't go through this network. Audio frequencies do. What they have is usually a pair of audio frequencies. One of them happens on the earliest modem, the Bell 103, latest run was F. They have two frequencies, 2025 hertz, and 2225 hertz. They had a 200 hertz shift. So you'd hear two tones banging back and forth. The earliest modems that you used to listen to, if you listened on an extension phone while your modem was busy chatting away, sounded just like that. If you ever watched science fiction theater, was the one I'm thinking of. Truman Bradley in the 50s when they had this TV show, you know, somewhere in the introduction or the end or somewhere in the middle, you'd hear this stuff that sounded exactly like that. It sounded like frequency shift came between those two frequencies. And you know where you'll hear it all the time? If you listen on a shortwave radio and you listen to radio teletype, you'll hear the shift between those two frequencies. So the phone line and radio cannot handle pulses. It doesn't know what a voltage is. It doesn't say, oh, that's, you know, this voltage or that voltage. It says, I only know frequencies because of the filter there. Pulses are DC, in effect. They're, you know, they're not, they have a lot of stuff, but essentially they are voltage levels, which means static measurement in a period of time of what an amplitude is. And that circuit is not equipped to handle it, but it can handle a tone A and a tone B. And if you shift between the tones at the right rate, you can do that. What happens when you're converting pulses into tones? You're doing a modulation process. You have an oscillator here and an oscillator there, and if it's a mark or space, you turn on this one or that one. And that's considered modulation because you're switching one rate into a similar rate using a certain carrier scheme. In a technically correct way, that is modulation.
Was frequency send and one was received?
No, one was spark and one was space. There's a send and a receive channel, so once you occupying a pair of frequencies and the receive is doing another pair. When you're doing the radio, it's usually done half duplex, which means you send, the other guy listens. He sends, you listen. And that's the way radio teletype works. You can't both send at the same time. You can, but you don't, because you're supposed to both share the same channel. In telephony, what they're doing is you're taking your 3,000 hertz bandwidth, and you actually get two channels. You get a voice, you get an ear and a mouth, is the ANM they call it. And you have a pair of wires going one way and a pair of wires going the other way. Now you'll say, yeah, but I looked at my telephone and there's four wires coming out of the wall, but only two are live. There's a little device in the telephone called a hybrid, which actually mixes them together and shifts one to a high frequency band and one to a lower frequency band. So they're multiplexed together. When they came out with, the best example is, if the telephone channel is 3,000 wide, it was real easy to go up to 2,400 baud. 2,400 bits per second would still fit in that space. When it went to higher rates than that, like 9,600, they had to ship multiple things, amplitudes and frequencies, and they had schemes that were pulse rate, pulse position. They had to do multiple schemes together. If they stacked them together, you could get a 9,600 baud mode. When you went higher than 9,600, which is about the most you could have a channel going this way and a channel going that way with all those modulation schemes operating at once, and you wanted to go to 14.4 and then 20, well, they have 33.6 for a while, and then they went to 56 with the V.90 protocol. They did that by data compression. It really wasn't true data rates. It was the effective data rate that was a combination of data compression schemes plus the modulation schemes put together. It's just a limited amount of space there. All right, so you had a detector here. The detector is really the demodulator, so it's stripped it away with a diode, capacitor, and a resistor. And I have bought these little devices from Hewlett-Packard called a detector. And I've taken them apart, and all there is those three, one diode, one resistor, one capacitor. And that's how I basically would take a modulated AM radio signal and pull the audio out of it. And it was built so that you could do that with their instruments. If you look at an old TV or radio schematic, you'll find that's all there is to the AM detector step. That's how AM's detected. How about FM? A little more complicated, but not necessarily. There's a simple one, and there are more complicated ways to do it. Let's talk about the simple one for now. Then we'll talk about single sideband. I'm going to actually do the FM. There's reasons for that. And then we'll talk about how we deal with the single sideband thing, because it really helps to understand this idea of mixing signals together. Time for spritz. It's funny, seeing over better aspect. Maybe when these dryer, the piece of markers get dried out or something, they don't erase so well. Maybe I just need to clean the eraser. Frequency deviating in correspondence with the amplitude. You got the deviation rate in correspondence with the frequency. What does it take to get the FM signal to give up its audio? The answer is really not much. If you want to do it by the most trivial method, it's called slope detection. Color One of the people that looked at my video said, you know, the trouble is if you don't use black, it kind of looks gray on the board and started to read, but sometimes I just have to do a little variation. Take a filter. And we showed one in the AM circuit. A capacitor, a resistor, and what it is a low pass filter. I guess maybe I will have to go to black because I confused myself. Since the board wasn't completely dry. All right. Low pass filter. What that really means is anything that's below a certain frequency will get through. Anything that's above a higher frequency, above the frequency that's defined by this time constant. Remember, T is the inverse of this. This is frequency of cycles per second. So time is the time per cycle. If you have a million cycles per second, the time for one cycle is a millionth of a second, a microsecond. If F is 1 million, T is 1 millionth. So what you need this is to be 1 millionth. If you're looking at 1 megahertz signal, if you want to have us a cutoff frequency, 1 millionth is 10 to the minus 6, 1 over. Since 10 to the plus 6 is 1 million, anything in the denominator is negative. Your R value and your C value should multiply together to be this. This is really easy because capacitors are typically 10 to the minus 12, or picofarads, or millionth farads. So, you know, you put about a million ohms here, and I don't even know what the correct term for the fraction of this 1/112, what 1, the power of minus 12 is, but it should be easy to produce time periods that you want in the range that would take a million cycles per second and trap them out. Anything above a million cycles per second is going to just basically roll off like that. That's the transition frequency. If you build the circuit with the right values. You also call this an integrator too, because at lower frequencies what's going to happen is it will just charge up. And this is the integral of turning on a step function like this. Over time it will build. Of this filter is that if I'm passing a signal through and its center frequency is 1 megahertz, it's going to be above and below that frequency. It's going to deviate left and right. This is frequency. And here's your 1 megahertz radio signal. And it's deviating above and below. When it does that, it rides up and down this slope. When it rides up and down the slope, what's this axis? Amplitude. These frequency shifts translate into amplitude shifts. This is the frequency shift. This is the corresponding amplitude shift that comes from it. A simple slope detector like that can convert frequency shifts into amplitude shifts, and in doing so, literally become the demodulator for an FM signal. So this FM demodulator has a name too. And that word is discriminator. Don't ask me why. But that's the name. Probably Armstrong himself decided to use it, and so it is. There's a couple of fancier ways to do this. One is a thing called a ratio detector, which is a circuit that literally does the same thing, turn frequency shifts into amplitude shifts. There's another cute way. You using what's called a phase lock loop, where you have an oscillator here. And its output goes to a counter. A counter, these are all digital circuits. Well, the oscillator isn't, but the counter is a digital circuit, literally called, counts the pulses. And there's more to it than that. There's a thing called a I don't think where it fits in the circuit. The thing I'm looking to put in there is called a comparator. Yeah, I think it goes here. The thing here is called a comparator. And what it's really doing is it's saying, okay, here's what the oscillator is doing. And what I'm going to compare it to, actually it's not doing that, it's comparing it to a preset. Basically, your modern radio receiver has, instead of a dial that you turn a knob and make a little slide rule, move back and forth, it has a set of numbers. Think of the radio receiver in your car. You turn a knob and you select the number. I want to listen to 97.9, whatever frequency you want to listen to. And the radio station shows up. How does that work? You're loading that number into a digital circuit down here. And a comparator is taking what the oscillator, which is the thing that sets the frequency that your radio receiver needs to use for selecting the radio station you want to get. And it says, I'm going to count the number of pulses I receive in a period of time, and that's going to be a frequency. I'm going to look at the frequency this dude wanted to have, and that's a frequency. And I'm going to compare it. If it's too high or too low,